Suddenly, I saw all three of the window cleaners stop dead in their tracks. They seemed to freeze against the wall of the house. None of them moved. This happened to them. Then the Duke asked me, What's gone wrong? I don't know, I answered. Then the giraffe with the monkey on her head tiptoed very gingerly away from the house and came towards us. The pelican flew with them. The giraffe came up very close to the Duke and whispered, "Your Grace, there is a man in one of the bedrooms of the third floor. He is opening all the drawers and taking things out. He's got a pistol." The Duke jumped about a foot in the air. "Which room?" he snapped. "So, show me at once." "It's the one on the third floor where the window is wide open," the giraffe whispered. "By gad," cried the Duke, "there's the Duchess's bedroom." He's after her jaws. "Call the police, summon the army. Bring up the cannon, charge with the light bridge." But even as he spoke, the pelican was flying up into the air. As he flew, he turned himself upside down and tipped the window cleaning wire out of his back. Then I saw the top half of that marvelous painted back sliding out of his head, ready for action. "What's the crazy bolt up to?" cried the Duke. "Wait and see," shouted the monkey. "Hold your breath, old man. Hold your nose, hold your horses, and watch the belly go." Like a bullet, the pelican flew in through the open window. And 5 seconds later, out he came again with his great orange back firmly closed. He landed on the lawn beside the Duke. A tremendous banging noise coming from inside the pelican back. I sounded as though someone was using a sledgehammer against it from the inside. "He's got him," cried the monkey. "Pelican's got the burglar in his back." "Well done, sir," shouted the Duke, hopping about with excitement. Suddenly, he pulled the handle of his working stick upward, and out of the hollow inside of the stick itself, he drew a long, thin, sharp, shining sword. "I'll run him through," he shouted. Flourishing the sword like a fencer. "Open up, pelican. Let me get at him. I'll run the bounder through before he knows what's happened to him. I'll speak him like a pat of butter. I'll feed his gizzle to my foxhounds." But the pelican did not open his back. He kept it firmly closed and shook his head at the Duke. The giraffe shouted, "The burglar is armed with a pistol. Your Grace, if Pally lets him out now, he'll shoot us all. He can be armed with a machine gun for all I care," bellowed the Duke, his massive muscle chills bristling like birch wood. "I'll handle the bleeding. Open, sir, open up." Suddenly, there was an ear-splitting bang, and the pelican leaped 20 feet into the air. "So did the Duke." "Watch out," the Duke shouted, taking 10 rape pants back down. "He's trying to shoot his way out." and pointing his sword at the pelican, he bellowed, "Keep that back closer. Don't you dare let him out. He'll murder us all." "Shake him up, Polly," cried the giraffe. "Rattle his bones. Teach him not to do it again." The pelican shook his head so fast from side to side that the back became a blur, and the man inside must have felt he was being scrambled like eggs. "Well done, Polly," cried the giraffe. "You're doing a great job. Keep on shaking him so he doesn't fire that pistol again." At this point, a lady with an enormous chest and fell flaming orange hair came flying out of the house screaming, "My jewels, somebody stole my jewels. My diamond tiara, my diamond necklace, my diamond bracelet, my diamond earring, my diamond ring. They've had the lot. My room has been ransacked." And then this massive female who 55 years ago had been a old famous opera singer suddenly burst into song. "My diamonds are over the ocean. My diamonds are over the sea. My diamonds were pinched for my bedroom. Oh, bring back my diamonds to me." We were so bowled over by the power of the lady's charm that all of us, excepting the pelican, the lady's charm that all of us, excepting the pelican, who had to keep his back closed, joined in the chorus. Bring back, oh, bring back my diamond to me, me. Bring back, oh, bring back me diamonds to me. "Come, you sir, Parentina," said the Duke. He pointed to the pelican and said, "This clever bird, this brilliant burglar-catching creature has saved the day. The bounder's in his bag." The Duchess stared at the pelican. The pelican stared back at the Duchess and gave her a wink. "If he's in there," cried the Duchess, "why don't you let him out? Then you can run him through with the famous sword of yours. I want my diamonds. Open your bag first." "No, no," shouted the Duke. "He's got a pistol. He'll murder us all. Someone must have called the police, because suddenly no less than four scoot cars came racing towards us with their sirens screaming. Within seconds, we were surrounded by six policemen, and the Duke was shouting to them, 'The villain you are after is inside the back of the bird. Stand by to collar him.' And to the pelican he said, 'Get ready to open up. Are you ready? Steady, go! Open her up.' The pelican opened his gigantic bag, and immediately the policeman pounced upon the burglar away from him and dragged him out and put handcuffs on his wrist. 'Great God!' shouted the chief of police. 'It's the cobra himself. The who? That the what?' everyone asked. 'Who's the cobra?' 'The cobra is the cleverest and most dangerous kid burglar in the world,' said the chief of police. 'He must have climbed up the drain pipe. The cobra can climb up anything.' 'My diamonds!' screamed the Duchess. 'I want my diamond. Where are my diamonds?' here they are, cried the chef of police. Fisher Gregg had food of jewelry from the burglar's pocket. The Duchess was so overcome with refilled that she fell to the ground in a faint. Then the police had taken away the first and burglar known as the Cobra and the fainting Duchess and been carried into the courthouse by her servants. The old Duke stood on the lawn with the giraffe, the pelican, the monkey, and me. Look, cried the monkey, the rodent burglar's bullet has made a hole in poor Pelly's back. That's done, said the pelican. Now, it won't be any use for holding water when we clean the window. Don't you worry about that, my dear Pelly, said the Duke, patting him on the back. My chauffeur will soon put a patch over it the same way he meant the tariffs on the roads, right? Now, we have far more important things to talk about than a little hole in the back. We stood there waiting to see what the Duke was going to say next. Now, listen to me, all of you, he said. The diamonds were not worth millions. And you have saved them. The monkey nodded. The giraffe smiled. The pelican blushed. No reward is to get ready for you, the Duke went on. I am therefore going to make you an offer which I hope will give you pleasure. I hereby invite the giraffe and the pelican and the monkey to live on my estate for the rest of their lives. I shall give you my best and largest hay barn as your private house, central heating, showers, a kitchen, and anything as you desire. For your comfort will be instilled. In return, you will keep my windows clean and pick my cherries and my apples. If the pelican is willing, perhaps he will also give me a ride in his back now and again. Oh, please, your grace, cried the pelican. Would you like a ride now? Later, said you. I have one after tea. At this point, the giraffe gave a nervous like conch and looked up at the sky. Is there a problem at the Duke? If there is, to please let me hear it. I don't like to sound ungrateful or pushy, mumbled the giraffe, but we do have one very pressing problem. We were all absolutely famished. We haven't eaten for days. My dear giraffe, cried the Duke. How very that last of me, food is no problem around here. I'm afraid it is not quite as easy as all that, said the giraffe. You see, I myself happen to be. Don't tell me, cried the Duke. I know it already. I'm an expert on the animals of Africa. The moment I saw you, I know you were the ordinary giraffe. You are of the generally brightly arena. You are absolutely right. Absolutely right, your grace, said the